know that we have roughly 120 years in combined military experience before us today, and two of our witnesses today, I think, were only in the job for a matter of days when they appeared before this subcommittee last year, and now they got a year and a few days under their belt. So we welcome them back. This hearing is just a great opportunity to identify areas where we can do more to help those who protect us and defend this nation. I don't have anything else I'd like to add at this moment except to recognize my friend and colleague, the ranking member, Mr. Bishop, for his opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and let me welcome these distinguished military career folks here. They're the folks that really, really take care of our soldiers, sailors, Marines, airmen, and we appreciate you very, very much for what you do. Sergeant Major Dailey, Sergeant Major of the Army, Master Chief Petty Officer, was it Stevens, Sergeant Major Green, and Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, Cody. Let me give a special shout out to Master Chief Petty Officer Michael Stevens and Chief Master Sergeant Cody. I know this is your last time coming before our subcommittee, and I want you to know that we appreciate your honest assessments regarding our enlisted personnel and what they face, and wish you the very best in your next assignment or retirement, whichever it is. I'll keep my remarks short so we can get directly to the hearing. I always look forward to this hearing because you give us the best picture of what is needed for those who are really on the front lines. We talk a lot about facilities, equipment, force structure, strategy, but it's the men and women like you that really make our military what it is today. I believe that our service members and the support of the family members, too, make our military great, and it's our responsibility to make sure that all of you, the active duty, reserve, the personnel, and their families are taken care of. And I want to make sure that we're doing enough to help our service members and the families, because the last thing they need to do when they're facing a deployment is worried about what's happening back home. On all of your testimonies, you raised many issues that confront your services, such as family services, retention, readiness, and training. And I want you to use this as an opportunity to tell us what we've gotten right, what we need to prove to ease the burden that's placed on our service members and their families. So thank you for your service, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop, and I'd like to at least introduce our witnesses today. Starting from my right is, of course, Sergeant Major of the Army, Dan Dailey, and most importantly, he's from Palmerton, Pennsylvania, just north of my hometown. And Sergeant Major Dailey is a returning witness. His wife, Holly, is also in attendance. Sergeant Major Dailey was sworn in as 15th Sergeant Major on January 30, 2015, 27 years of service, enlisted in the Army in 1989, attended basic training and advanced individual training at Fort Benning, Georgia, place near and dear to your heart, Mr. Bishop. And Sergeant Major Dailey's awards include the Legion of Merit and Bronze Star Medal with Valor. Thanks for being back here, Sergeant Major. Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy, Michael D. Stevens, as Mr. Bishop said, this is his last appearance before us, and we wish him all the best in his future endeavors, wherever that may be, and who knows, maybe Pennsylvania. But Master Chief Stevens is a returning witness. His wife, Teresa, is also in attendance. just wanted to mention that he was appointed on September 28, 2012, becoming the 13th Master Chief Petty Officer. 33 years of service, entered the Navy straight from high school in 1983. Master Chief has served in as Wing Command Master Chief for the largest helicopter wing in the U.S. Navy, most recently served as 16th Fleet Master Chief for the U.S. Fleet Forces Command. Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps, Ronald Green, who was, I think, 5 days into the job when he came before us last year. Sergeant Major Green's returning witness. He assumed his current post as the 18th Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps on February 20th, 2015. 31 years of service. He has served as Drill Sergeant, Master Drill Sergeant at Paris Island. pity those poor guys who had to deal with you. he served at two three-star commands, a rare distinction for rank. He served the Marine Corps Forces Europe and Africa in Stuttgart, Germany in 2010. And, of course, Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, James Cody, and this is also his last appearance, and we appreciate your presence here, and we always like to point out that he was well-trained. His wife is in attendance as well, and is too a retired Air Force chief with over 25 years of service. Appointed in January 2013 as the 17th Chief Master Sergeant, 32 years of service, entered the Air Force in 1984. His background includes various duties in air traffic control at the unit and major command levels. He served overseas in Germany, South Korea, Turkey, and deployed in support of Operations Southern Watch and Enduring Freedom. Thank you all for taking your time to be with us here today. And without objection, your written statements will be entered into the record, and please feel free to summarize your remarks in about 5 minutes each. So I guess we'll start with, well, I guess we'll go from right to left, starting with Sergeant Major Dailey. Thank you all for your statements.
Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, distinguished members of this committee, I want to thank you on behalf of myself and my comrades for allowing us the opportunity to speak with you today. On behalf of more than 2 million members of our Army team and its leaders, I'd like to recognize this committee for its continued support in defending and advancing all facets of Army quality of life. We are especially grateful for the $974 million in fiscal year 2016 funding for military construction. These authorizations and appropriations result in intangible quality of life improvements, including the $19 million Non-Commissioned Officer Academy at Fort Drum, New York. This complex will provide the Army's NCOs a state-of-the-art facility to further develop the leadership skills and professional standards expected of our Army's young leaders. We aren't officially at war today, but right now as we stand, more than 186,000 of our soldiers are in support of our combatant commanders in over 140 countries. They're preventing, shaping, and winning for our nation. Although our force is getting smaller, our mission has not changed. The nation has asked our Army to perform a diverse number of missions over the last year, requiring a force prepared for anything, anytime, and anywhere. Maintaining our readiness, as the Army Chief of Staff has said, is our number one priority, and there is no other number one. We build readiness by filling the Army formations with soldiers of character, competence, and commitment. Soldiers who are mentally, emotionally, and physically fit to withstand the rigors required of members of the profession of arms. In my opinion, we can be best supported with readiness by keeping faith with our greatest asset, the American soldier. Increasing and incentivizing deployability, maintaining standards and discipline, and expanding our professional development improvements. I hope to have the opportunity to share some of those initiatives with you today. Ladies and gentlemen, I do believe that our soldiers are the best trained, best manned, and best equipped force in history. It is essential that we maintain this consistent and predictable resourcing to stay that way. We must remain committed to providing this great nation the most capable and lethal force imaginable, not only to win, but to deter any potential adversary. But caring for soldiers, families, and our civilian workforce is non-negotiable for me and the thousands of leaders that I represent here today. Caring for our people builds trust, and trust is built with honesty and predictability. This is the unwritten contract between the American people, her leaders, and the people of our Army. My biggest concern in the delicate balance of building a quality of life for our soldiers and families that enables readiness is how they will experience the cumulative effects of budgetary decisions designed to bring a cost savings to the military. Fiscal conservation is our duty as leaders and public servants, but it's hard to explain program and compensation cuts to a young soldier and his or her family. Whether actual or perceived, these things affect how they view our decisions. I visit dozens of installations throughout the last year, and I've spoken to thousands of our soldiers and their families, and they ask me why. We have to ask ourselves, is the value of these cuts worth the potential impact to our soldiers and their families? They're still deploying, and they're still separating from their families. And we have to be cognizant of the fact that chipping away at the Army family's wallet could violate the trust the soldier has in us. It could jeopardize their trust, and as we expect them to be committed to the mission that we direct them to do, we owe it to them. Being good stewards of our nation's fiscal resources does not mean that we should do so at the expense of our soldiers. We are asking for them to give their all. We have to keep faith with the men and women who make up our total Army family. With the continued support of this committee, trust can and will be sustained. These soldiers, our Army professionals, who make up today's all-volunteer Army, stand ever ready and willing to answer the nation's call because they believe in each other. They believe in you, and they believe in me. We must ensure our actions and decisions always reinforce that trust. This committee's support, I'm sure, will do just that. This will defend. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time, and I appreciate your questions.
Thank you, Sergeant Major Dailey. Master Chief Stevens.
Good morning, Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and distinguished members of this subcommittee. It's a great honor to be here with you as my wife and I address you in my fourth year as the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy. There are currently over 600,000 active and reserve sailors and civilians serving in our Navy today. Their commitment to our Navy and our nation is never-ending. It's a never-ending source of inspiration. Without our sailors' can-do spirit and determined initiative, our operational readiness simply could not exist. Our sailors and their families collectively make up our most critical weapon system, a weapon system that operates most effectively when individual and unit morale is high. I truly believe that if this weapon system is not operating at its highest proficiency, our Navy becomes far less capable. We owe it to our sailors and their families to ensure they continue to be well prepared to safeguard our nation. We owe it to them to provide them with education, training, and appropriate compensation for their service and sacrifice. We owe it to them to hold the line when budget pressures put their quality of life and quality of service at risk. Over the past three decades, there have been significant improvements in pay raises, housing allowance, health care, and veterans benefits, resulting in a quality of life that is commensurate with their service. Many of you have worked hard to get us where we are today, and it is my hope that your hard work will not be in vain. Although the nature of budgetary reform is to balance readiness with quality of life, sailors are apprehensive about actual and potential reductions regarding pay and compensation. Through the years, military and civilian leadership has worked hard to establish and maintain trust with our sailors. Now, we have to work hard to preserve and nurture that trust. Outside military pay and compensation, one of my greatest concerns is single sailor housing. Although we monitor barrack safety and prioritize funds for facilities most in need, we are not recapitalizing unaccompanied housing at the rate in which it is degrading. As we prioritize military construction projects to enable operational readiness, we have difficulty meeting the requirements for infrastructure, such as barracks and support buildings. The necessary investment in shore infrastructure remains challenging, but it's important for us to remember that our sailors rely on these installations for operational support, training, and quality of life for them and their families. If we start to invest now in improvements in this area, the less costly it will be down the road. It is my hope that Congress continues to provide the needed relief without needing to move money out of operational readiness accounts in the future. Although these concerns exist, fleet manning remains healthy and continues to improve. Healthcare continues to be extremely important to our sailors and their families. Our stateside and overseas military treatment facilities are essential to ensuring our sailors and their families have access to comprehensive, high-quality healthcare services. Our family programs continue to provide fundamental support that our sailors require to succeed in their personal and professional lives. Our sailors and their families appreciate your support in this area and wanted you to know how important these programs are towards their total quality of life. When a sailor is deployed and the spouse has to work to help make ends meet, having a daycare with extended hours makes all the difference in the world to manage everyday life while apart. Sailors that are deployed for 7 months at a time are more focused on the mission, knowing that their spouse and families have help available if anything unplanned was to come up while they're away. Having resources such as an ombudsman or a counselor accessible to the spouse makes getting through a deployment more manageable and less stressful for both the sailors and their families. And for these benefits, we thank you. We can never take for granted the sacrifice that our sailors and their families make. It is absolutely critical to the future of our nation's defense that we do everything in our power to hold the line and provide our sailors and their families with the best quality of life we can offer. On behalf of these amazing sailors and their families, I thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to address you today and very much look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Master Chief Stevens. Sergeant Major Green, you're recognized.
Yes, sir. Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today and update you on the quality of life of your Marine Corps and our families. First, I'd like to thank you for your fidelity to the United States Marine Corps. The Commandant, Joan Nell, and I continue to travel around the globe, visiting our Marines and families, and the morale is high. The Corps continues to maintain its operational readiness and commitment to the nation by remaining forward deployed and ready to respond to crisis anywhere in the world. Without any hesitation or mental reservation, you and the American people expect Marines to answer the call and to win battles. In 2015, your Marines executed approximately 100 operations, 20 amphibious operations, 140 theater security cooperation events, and 160 major exercises. We have accomplished these requirements while sustaining a tenet of measured and responsible drawdown. We are keeping the faith with our Marines by minimizing involuntary attrition and maximizing voluntary actions. The Corps is not seeing significant issues with recruiting or retention and continues to attract recruit the best and most qualified individuals. We will continue to maintain a force of the highest quality people who are intelligent, physically fit, resilient, and disciplined. General Nell and I spent Thanksgiving and Christmas visiting our forward deployed warriors, and they're doing a great job. You'd be proud of them. There are presently over 33,000 Marines deployed around the globe, and despite the drawdown in Iraq and Afghanistan, the enemy continues to try and impose their will and their way of life on our nation. Your Corps continues to accomplish the mission by changing their minds or their zip codes. Our families remain resilient and committed to supporting the warfighters as they work to accomplish the mission of guarding the country and our way of life. The Corps recognizes that we have a drawdown and continue to shape our quality of life programs and reflect those changes. As we near our end strength target rapidly, the funding levels continue to eat away at our readiness and force the Commandant of the Marine Corps to accept risk in unit readiness, personal readiness, and family readiness. All three are tied directly to the quality of life. The Corps should not have to make decisions between quality of work and quality of life. The Marine Corps works hard every day to take the fight to the enemy and make the fight as unfair as possible. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you this morning, and I welcome your questions.
Thank you, Sergeant Major Green. And we'll go to Chief Master Sergeant Cody, you're recognized.
Chairman Dent, Ranking Member Bishop, and members of the Subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to be here today and for your interest in the quality of life of our servicemen and women. I sincerely appreciate the opportunity to represent America's airmen and their families. It's an honor to express their needs and offer appreciation for your support on their behalf. Chairman Dent, I appreciate you acknowledging Athena's service. She continues to serve, and certainly I wouldn't be able to do it without it. I'd also like to take a moment to have you recognize a brand new senior enlisted leader for our Air Force Reserve Command. Chief Master Sergeant Erica Kelly has just taken over in that position, so going to be a valuable asset to our team. Today, your airmen serve in unprecedented times. After 25 years of constant combat operations, they face a dynamic, unpredictable future and an increasingly desire to rely on air power. They serve in the smallest, oldest Air Force in our history, but continue to provide the preponderance of combat force against our adversaries around the globe. The poignant words of the Air Force Chief of Staff General Wells should not be lost on any of us. Quantity has a quality of its own. There is no doubt today's airmen are the most talented, educated, and experienced force our country has ever assembled. They are professional men and women who are proud to serve, but remain concerned as fiscal restraints limit their capacity to accomplish the mission and erode a compensation they earn in service to our nation. During my 3 years as Chief Master Sergeant in the Air Force, limited budgets have forced your Air Force to cut its manpower by nearly 24,000 airmen. However, combat operations around the globe have remained steady for our Air Force in some areas while escalating in others. As of this January, there are 24,000 airmen deployed worldwide and more than 205,000 airmen directly supporting combatant commanders every single day. In that same time period, diminished budgets have forced slowing of normal growth and compensation and have continually cut at our airmen's buying power. If the Budget Control Act is not repealed and current trends continue, our projections show that compensation for an average E5 with dependents stationed in or near the Washington, D.C. will fall behind private sector pay in 2018 and behind increases in household expenses in 2021. As we continue to implement these reforms and measures, including changes to retirement, basic allowance for housing, TRICARE, and more, we must never lose sight of the full impact of our airmen's readiness and resilience, as well as our ability to recruit and retain your all-volunteer professional force. The airmen who serve today do so freely, proudly, and voluntarily because they believe in what America stands for and are ready to defend its cause. But our nation must honor that commitment by providing for them and their families. I believe you've had a chance to read my written statement, which I have submitted for the official record. It includes greater details on our efforts to invest in infrastructure and key family programs, though there is clearly more we could offer our airmen and families with a higher top-line budget. It outlines recruiting and education initiatives, including our effort to develop a bachelor's degree program for enlisted airmen, and other concerns of our airmen and families, such as recent proposals to eliminate basic allowance for housing for married couples and airmen who choose to live together. I would like to add again for the record that I strongly oppose any such proposal as it penalizes a military member. Basic allowance for housing is an individual entitlement that comes with military service, and it should not be taken away for deciding to marry or live with another brave volunteer. I thank you again for the opportunity to provide insight into the quality of life of our airmen. I appreciate your continued support for our brave airmen and their supportive families, and for your commitment to protect the quality of life initiatives they need to confidently defend our nation. Our airmen are counting on each of you to lead our nation and ensure we have the resources to remain the world's greatest Air Force. I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Chief Master Sergeant. You always have one perennial question at this hearing. It's what would you say are the top three quality of life concerns of enlisted personnel in your service branch? And I know in the past we've talked a lot about housing, barracks, child care centers, health care, wounded warrior care, dwell time. I'm just curious to see if any of the priorities have shifted. And maybe we'll start with the answers starting from left to right. We'll start with Chief Master Sergeant Cody, moving the other direction.
So, Chairman Dent, thank you. I think number one on the concern area for our airmen and their families right now is compensation. It dominates almost every conversation we have with them when we visit, in the fact that they see the slowing of their growth and the reduction in their buying power. And there is nothing in the foreseeable future that would indicate to them that that is going to stop. So as they balance their ability to continue to serve their nation as a family, that's a major concern. They worry about the impact on readiness and exactly whether we'll have the resources to continue to do what we're being asked to do. So I expressed in my opening comments that our real demand signal for air power has not diminished. Arguably, it has increased, while the size of our force has significantly decreased over this past 25 years. So that you know, levies on them a lot. And then the things that you mentioned still remain a concern. Adequate child care, housing are major concerns of them as they are moved around the globe, and having access to those resources are important.
Yes, sir. Sir, the most important things to the Marines and families as a commandant and I travel around, the number one thing, questions being asked right now, is the blended retirement system. Because they understand the system that we're on, sitting at this table, but they don't fully understand what's going to be in the future for them. The Marines that are in now will have a choice. Most of them will have a choice, either one system or the other. And January 1st, 2018, the system is supposed to, you know, be the system that we're on from then on. And I know we're paddling away trying to get that information out there, but it's very important. It is absolutely important as we change a system to something we have no control over. And that ship will take a long time to turn if we get it wrong. For everybody that's going to retire under that new system, that's a question that we're really trying to answer for them. The Commandant has an unpaid priority list. Barracks is a part of that. Structures, the 24-hour gyms, all the quality of life programs that are challenged by readiness. Because I continuously say, you know, you can't separate unit readiness, personal readiness, and family readiness. So the budget that we've been handed does not support everything that's in the backpack. It just doesn't. It just doesn't. And we must make A's on the battlefield. We have to make A's on the battlefield. So that leaves the Commandant with some challenges with quality of life programs. childcare, BAH minus one, you know. We understand that 61% of our $23.4 billion go toward paying the warriors and supporting all the benefits. And there's only $9 billion left to do everything else, operations, modernization, research, technology, all those things we look at holistically. We look at it holistically, sir. And the $1.2 billion that's lost from the budget of last year to this year, it affects all quality of life in the Marine Corps. Yes, sir.
Well, number one, I believe, Mr. Chairman, is the resources to do their job. We call that quality of work. Having the parts, the tools, the right weapons, the systems that are necessary to effectively carry out their mission. So we're doing a pretty good job of that, but we're having to move some monies around to make that happen. So we're assuming risk in areas like quality of life, understanding that that's necessary. Number two is this potential or this discussion that we've been having for the last 3 years on pay and compensation. Some of it's occurred and some of it has not. But in the minds of sailors and their families, when I go out and talk to them, if this discussion is happening at very senior levels, they feel that it's just a matter of time before it actually occurs. So there's the perceived and then there's the actual. And it creates a level of anxiety that's not healthy for the force. So that would be number two. Number three, as I mentioned in my oral statement, is our inability to keep up with our shore infrastructure repairs, such as barracks and work facilities and things like that, in order to ensure that we're meeting the mandate of what I identified as number one, which is quality of work. We're having to move monies out of these areas so that they can do the mission. It's not something that is in the spotlight, you know, housing, or I'm not saying housing, shore infrastructure. It's not in the spotlight, so it doesn't get a lot of attention. But one of these days, we're going to wake up and we're going to realize that we've got a disaster out there, and we've got more to do than we've got money to do it with. So I just caution us to not take our eye off the shore infrastructure ball. Thank you.
Chairman Dent, the Army's concerns are aligned with the priorities of the Chief Staff of the Army. And the reason why is because that's where we need to always maintain our focus. Number one is the total force readiness. And today I'm represented not just by myself, but the National Guard Sergeant Major Brunk Conley, and Command Sergeant Major Jim Wills from the Army Reserve. And as we draw our Army to a historic lows, 980,000 in 2018, readiness will always be our number one concern. And that's where we need to focus our attention, because we do need predictable resourcing in order to make sure that our soldiers are prepared to do the mission we ask them to do. Number two would be the future of the force. We got to look beyond the next few years, and we have to look out many years. You've heard the Secretary, the Chief, and the Secretary of Defense say that. And that's true. We have potential adversaries out there that we have to maintain focus on. And the future of the force requires, again, consistent and reliable resourcing in order to make sure that we stay well above the pace of our adversaries. And then our third priority, which is aligned with the Chief's priorities, is our soldiers and families. They are our Army. I'm represented here today by my wife, but she also is a representation of the part of the 2 million person team that makes up the Army. It's not just soldiers, but it's families and our great civilian leaders. And they trust us that we will maintain pace with the resources that we need to be able to make sure that they can take care of their families while our soldiers are doing the things that we ask them to do. I share similar concerns with each one of my senior enlisted advisors to my right, is that our soldiers aren't asking for much. We just need to be able to provide them the necessary resources they need to accomplish their mission.
Sergeant Major, at this time I'll recognize the ranking member for his questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate very much your comments about your priorities. But whenever I meet with service members and military families, they inevitably mention being concerned about the changes to their benefits. So I just want to ask each of you, has the continuing discussion over the changing military benefits impacted morale? I mean, what are you really hearing from your soldiers, Marines, sailors, and airmen And what factors should we be considering as this issue continues to move forward? Because I know that as I happen to co-chair the Congressional Military Family Caucus, and these are issues that families are talking about, the erosion of benefits and, quote, perks. How is that impacting, and how do you predict it will further impact recruitment, retention, and morale? Each service member, with the changes proposed in the retirement package, is going to have to assume a great deal of responsibility for planning for his or her retirement, making investment selections, choose their monthly contribution percentage. And that's going to require a great deal of financial literacy training on the part of the various services. So in addition to the first question I ask, I'd like for you to describe, each of you, what your services are doing at this point to implement the requirement for creating the necessary financial literacy for the service members and their families.
So I can go first, Mr. Bishop. So I think we're actually all part of, all the services are part of a working group right now where we're trying to figure out exactly how we're going to do that continuum of financial education. So I think all the services do some financial counseling today, but it's in a much very, it's a different context completely. Basically, how do you not spend more money than you have today and live within a budget? Not how do you plan for the future? And I think you eloquently kind of identified what our real challenge is when you think about the preponderance of our force and where they're coming into the military and what their level of education would be. And how do we make sure we get that right up front? So I think the working group is addressing all of the concerns that you've kind of laid out. I think it's too early to say what we will be then able to do, right? You take all those recommendations, we'll see how you would execute that throughout the continuum of service in our military to at least give the best opportunity for our service members to make the right type of choices. But as you kind of state, choices are just that. Some people will make good ones. Some people will likely not make good ones, and that could end up, in the end, having a detrimental effect on what their retirement would actually be worth. So I think that's right. And again, I think you hit it. That's why I brought it up as the number one concern I hear about compensation and eroding growth. We shouldn't shy away from the conversation. It is going to and is having an impact on retention.
Okay, recruitment, retention, and morale.
Yeah, so the morale is tied to retention, I think. You know, when people have lower morale, because they don't feel they're being adequately compensated, or they think that they're not going to be adequately compensated, and we are asking their families to sacrifice in that same vein, right? We talk a lot about the spouses and their employment. That goes to overall income in a household, and how we move our folks around and the things that we ask them to do. So they're taking deductions there in many, many cases, and then, okay, we're not going to grow your pay at the same rate that you would normally grow or the law allowed for. All of that plays in. I think it impacts recruitment. It's tough to tell because we're doing okay with recruitment also, but you pay attention. The fact is, though, a lot of those people that serve are our best recruiters. If they're not talking to people about the advantages of service and the overall package and how this is a great way of life and a good thing to do for your nation, it has a negative impact. I think, again, we're doing okay today. It's hard to say long-term what that will have for impact.
Sergeant Green?
Yes, sir. First, morale, sir. I alluded to, the three types of readiness, unit, personal, and family. For Marines want to deploy. They want to be on the side of contingency or crisis. And when they can't deploy, the morale begins to be low because the budget cuts that we're facing, as I alluded to earlier, the Commandant and having to make choices about ranges, training areas, the technology and resources, because the Marines want to know when we go to the fight. Like I said, there's no fair fight. There's no fair fight. We want to make it as unfair as possible. And we have to take cuts in modernization. Equipment can't be reset, refurbished, can't sustain the barracks. That's a draw on personal morale. It is. And we owe them the very best. Recruiting, like the Air Force, It's great right now. But we want to make sure it stays that way, because we can look back, pre 9/11, we put a lot of money into the war. A lot of lives lost. A lot of warriors come back, families torn apart, and everything. Just want to make sure that you know all we've accomplished over the last 14 or 15 years. We're not trying to go back with a budget to pre-9/11, because nothing today costs what it did pre-9/11. Nothing. Some things have doubled and tripled, and that needs to be recognized. Then there are warriors out there and family members who absolutely need health services. Health services. And, you know, to see the budget cut, and our Wounded Warrior Regiment, we're going to keep the faith with our wounded warriors and their families first. We're going to do that. But what are we not going to do? What are we not going to do? We want to make sure we're retaining. You talk about retention. We're retaining the most qualified Marine, not just Marines. We want to make sure that the Marines, we know we put out, every year, sir, one out of four Marines that came in 4 years ago will leave the Marine Corps. We're only going to keep one out of four. We want to make sure we have a choice to keep the best of the four, the most qualified Marine. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. That was it, sir.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to recognize Mr. Baldale for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for your time today. And I don't want to change the subject too much because of obviously compensation is something that has a huge plays a huge role in this. But there is something that did come up quite a bit on my trip that I had out to the USS Ronald Reagan and spent some time with our sailors. And it has to do with their life after service and training, job opportunities. I know that was mentioned a little bit with some of the things that Chief Master Sergeant Cody mentioned in his comments. But I'd like to ask Master Chief Petty Officer, can you discuss the transition GPS as well as how you see opportunities to better help out in the transition process and hopefully lower the unemployment rates for post-9/11 veterans?
The current transition assistance program goals, plans, and success is far better than what we've had in the past. I personally had the opportunity to attend it a few months back. It still needs some work, but the good news is we recognize that through course and class surveys, and each time they go back for another round and make the necessary adjustments to continue for this process to get better. We call it the spiral concept. You learn as you go. And as long as you're making those adjustments based on what you're learning, then you'll be better in the end. What I would really like to focus on, and I would ask that we give this serious consideration, is we need to do a better job of credentialing across the services. It's something that I think I've mentioned or we've talked about for 4 years now. It's very difficult, I understand, because there's federal credentials, there's state and local credentialing, and it can become difficult, and there's a lot of bureaucracy behind it. But if we could find a way across the department and across the Capitol Hill to come to some agreement where we could at least tackle some of these credentialing issues in the macro, because what I've recognized is the Army will be doing something, the Air Force is doing something, the Navy and the Marine Corps, but we're not doing much together as a department. So if we could do a better job at that, I believe that might makes our service members far more marketable when they go out into the civilian sector and into industry, because oftentimes that's what they want to see. What are your credentials? And these service members have the experience and the knowledge and the know-how, but it doesn't always translate to civilian credentialing. And in order for it to happen, many times they want that service member to go back through the very same training that they've already received and have the practical job application experience that they already have. And it's money out of the GI Bill, it's money out of their pockets, it's time. You know, when they get out of the service, they need to go to work. They got families to support. They don't always have time to spend another 2 years in school working part-time. I really believe we can do a better job. I just haven't seen a concerted effort to tackle credentialing. We're doing a pretty good job in the education piece, but not a really good job in the credentialing piece.
Would any of the other three like to add to that?
I would, sir, if I could. Congressman, and again, thanks for the opportunity to address this issue, because this is something the Army has invested heavily in for the last several years, and as MEPCOM Stephen says, we are very passionate about. We have made great strides. The Army has become 88% compliant with the VOW Act in the last 3 years, and we've had great help through Congress in making great strides with regards to credentialing and helping our great communities recognize the value of our service men and women that leave our service. But I agree with my counterpart. There's a lot more that we can do. But as a result of our efforts together, we have seen some great improvement. Since 2012 to 2015, the Army alone has reduced its non-employment compensation from over $512 million down to $250 million. So that's a tangible result of the amount of result that we can receive from just small inputs to this. And I agree with MEPCOM Stevens. An area that we can advance this even further and reduce that $250 million down even more with a small investment into things like credentialing. Ideas that we have to look outside the scope of what we do now. We got to open our aperture on things like tuition assistance and allow our young men and women who deserve those credentials, the great skills that they hone while they're soldiers, sailors, and a Marine can be added upon with these credentials, and they'll be more valued service members when they transition, become soldiers for life in the future. And it's a small investment. A lot of times these credentials cost from anywhere from $150 to $500. And there's no reason that we can't invest in them, because we have proven that investing in them now is a great investment for us in the future.
Thank you. I think my time's up.
Mr. Farr, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm very interested in this dialogue on compensation, which you indicate is really a high priority with low morale. And I really do think we have to have a national dialogue on it, because I think what, and I wonder if you have the tools to respond to the military families of sort of put that into comparison. Because what I find is that we're sort of the, you know, everybody who's in my area, it's livable wage, can't afford even their minimum wage in California is way ahead of the rest of the country. You're speaking to a Congress that won't improve the minimum wage in America. It ought to be $15 an hour to survive. But when you also put it in context, I can't believe that the private sector could really lure away people. I mean, you've got, and we're talking about it, we've got a lot of benefits here. The private sector doesn't offer the child care provisions that you do. The private sector doesn't offer free access to clinics for uniformed personnel or a TRICARE kind of program for spouses and children. Certainly nothing like a welfare morale account that soldiers can take advantage of for discounts. I mean, I'm totally for you. But I think that it's unfair for somebody to say it's just not enough. I mean, Congress members haven't had a COLA, not a COLA, in 10 years. Talk about the morale here and on, you know, salaries. And our retirement. I'm going to retire after 26 years of federal service. And the retirement is $60,000. People think we make a tons of money. It's not a lot. And so I think that, but on the other hand, when we go to recruit for people in our offices, during the boom, nobody wanted to work for federal government because the salaries were so low. But now, people are lining up for their jobs. Salaries are the same, but the benefits that the government pays are so much better. So particularly for working moms, they love the federal job. So I wish we'd put this into a real national context, because I think the anger out there the voters are expressing, sort of hating government, is because they don't understand the pros and cons here of what it is. And so that's just my opinion. I think we ought to put it into context, because if any soldier comes to me and says, you know, I think that you guys are shortchanging us, I'll say, yeah, we're not doing enough. On the other hand, you're not going to get a better benefit going working for IBM. Now, the question I really wanted to get to was, I'd like to help you in your professionalization of enlisted personnel. And, you know, I represent the Defense Language Institute, and I'm very, very interested in your concepts or your ideas and asymmetrical threats. Of now's the time when we really have to understand the languages and, more importantly, the cultures of other countries. And should we be allowing the senior enlisteds into programs like and into the Naval Postgraduate School, which is usually an officer candidate school, or AFIT or DLI, Defense Language Institute, for those kind of training, professional training in languages and culture.
So, Congressman, if I could, I...
One last question. I just want to throw this out there for staff and everybody. When we, the discussion here about lowering the BAW, you know, we entered into contracts with the private sector to build all the community residential housing, and that contract promised that contractor for 50 years they would be able to collect the BAW, and no one told them, hey, we're going to be changing that formula. What's that going to do to the...
Puts it at risk.
Yeah.
Significant risk.
Aren't there contractual obligations there that can't be violated?
So they'll get their money. The problem is they won't recapitalize as necessary. That's the way the contracts are written. So the way it's written and the structure of it, there's a built-in amount of that BAW that goes to recapitalization. That is exactly where they will take it. They will sustain their ability to fulfill, you know, their obligations to their employees and their investors and everything like that, but it will in turn not be able to sustain a 50-year program because the recapitalization won't take place. That's at least how we're being, as we had their dialogue with them with these discussions.
Mr. Chairman, we ought to just take that issue and try to get to the bottom of it because it's going to require billions of dollars.
If I could respond to your comments, sir, and then I will certainly agree with you about what you're talking about, the opportunities for education and language-enabled airmen, specifically for my thing. But I think you're absolutely right. We need to have this conversation about compensation, about those that serve their country. But let's have the real conversation of what we're asking them to do.
Yeah.
Because we're not asking everybody at IBM to travel the globe and put themselves in harm's way and come back a different person for the rest of their life, and their family have to contend with that. If we want to have the real conversation, let's have the real conversation, not just try to arbitrarily, you know, correlate their service, what they do for their nation, to what anybody else does for our nation. This is unique. It is less than 1% of the American population that serves their country and is willing to do what they do. So fair and appropriate compensation is the right conversation. What that is, we do have to decide. I think where we have this conversation and where we struggle in talking to them is they committed to this. You walk in and you, just like you talked, you walked into Congress knowing this is what it was going to look like. Okay, I make that commitment. That's the organization I'm going to be part of. You start changing that. Well, now it's an appropriate conversation to say, what did I commit to? Is that really right? And our nation can't afford to have these folks after the investment that we put into them, that the country puts in them to be capable airmen. So I think it's right to have the conversations, but in the right context also of what we're asking them to do. You couldn't be more appropriate, and we're trying to do this in the Air Force. So we are sending senior enlisted to language-enabled programs. We have them embedded in AFIT. We've talked about this over the years as we've come before your committee. So I really appreciate your continued support and emphasis on the value of that in creating a more capable serviceman or woman to be able to do what our nation is definitely asking them.
Yep. I need to recognize that this time, Mr. Jolly, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chief Cody, thank you for that explanation. I appreciate that. Sergeant Major Dailey, I want to follow up on a conversation Mr. Valadeo had. You've been very gracious in working with me on this credentialing issue, and I think the panel would benefit a little bit from further conversation about this. Sergeant Dailey hosted a CODEL that I was able to lead with a lot of our state legislators and our state regulators to identify what the state of Florida could do differently to begin to accept the credentials within the state and create this more seamless transition. As part of that, I learned a little bit about what you were doing with Army University. Can you share a little bit about how Army University is going to support ultimately this more seamless transition of credentialing from in-service to separation?
Absolutely. First, I'd like to acknowledge, sir, the thank you for your support on CODEL and for championing our credentialing efforts. And I mean that it really helps. And I would invite anyone else out to come see the Herculean efforts that our soldiers and our transition professionals are doing in each one of our installations. But I'd absolutely like to highlight our efforts at Army University. So we believe that our nation gives our men and women the best quality training and experience they need to fight and win our nation's wars. We also believe that training and education aligns very closely with what our nation needs in technical fields. So for 240 years, we have done just that. We've trained and readied our men and women to fight and win, and we've given them skills at the cost of our taxpayers. But we can do a better job, because we owe it to them, soldiers for life, to be able to transition into civilian service, because back to civilian service, so they can be valued members of their communities. And it's at a very low cost, as I mentioned before. It's a very small investment for a very large return, not just for the military, not just for not paying unemployment compensation, but back to the communities they'll go into. Will they become good citizens, taxpayers, contributing to the community and valuing on the things that we've already paid for? Just this year alone, the United States Army has credentialed over 30,000 soldiers with the efforts from the help of this Congress and the efforts internally to the Army. But as I mentioned before, a small investment, opening up the aperture for things like tuition assistance to allow them to use those great gifts from our taxpayers to find credentialing opportunities is an inexpensive way to continue to find value for our young men and women as they leave the service.
But it allows them to essentially be recognized with credit for some of the performance and the trade skills that they have developed while in service. It now credentials them in a way that can harmonize with outside credentialing agencies. And we're still getting there, but that's the direction we're going. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Okay. And I would share with the panel, our Florida delegation learned a lot from something the North Carolina legislature actually enacted at the state level to help streamline this. And as a result, in Tallahassee this session, there's now legislation moving through at our state level to begin to accept and accommodate more of the in-service credentials for soldiers that separate. So I appreciate that. Anything this committee can do to help, certainly we stand ready. Another question for you. In your testimony, you state that there are nearly 100,000 soldiers who are unable to deploy, and that approximately 80% of these soldiers are not able to deploy because of medical issues. In the context of a force drawdown to an active duty force of 450 and perhaps total force of 980, I believe is the number, 100,000 soldiers being termed non-deployable, what is that impact on our readiness, and is that an issue that we need to be prepared to begin to address?
Congressman, absolutely. And that number does represent the total force, 980,
right,
the active force, the National Guard and Reserve. We have done a lot of things over several years to take care of our wounded warriors and soldiers. As a result of that, we've told our nation that we represent our young men and women, and we will represent them for life at the end of this service. But we do have to be cognizant of the fact that this takes a toll on our readiness, as you explained, sir. So we're working initiatives right now to ensure that each one of our soldiers, as we draw down to the historic lows that you mentioned, sir, 450 from an active component and 980 as a total force, to ensure that each one of the men and women that we remain on active duty can and are able to fight and win this nation's wars.
And so that would mean addressing the current population of 100,000 that are non-deployable.
It would, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
And we currently are doing that, I can assure you, sir.
Okay.
And each one of those soldiers, I can assure you, will be taken care of. This is by no means any way to not say we're not going to take care of our soldiers.
Okay.
We're going to give them the appropriate care they need, but we do have to come to the understanding that it's time to transition into soldiers for life.
Okay. Very good. No further questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Recognize Mr. Price at this time for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I too want to follow up on some of the implications of the budget difficulties we've heard discussed very consistently today, and the drawdown that we're anticipating. I think it needs to be said that these budget woes are created by us. It's not like they were handed down from above. It's a very similar account to what we heard earlier this week in the Transportation Housing Subcommittee. But we passed the Budget Control Act. We passed sequestration in this body, and because we couldn't get a budget agreement, sequestration kicked in. We've patched it for 2 years, but we've not fixed it. And the irony is, with all this, with this, all these budget woes, with all of this, we are not addressing the real drivers of the deficit. So at the end of the day, for all of this cutting in both the domestic and military budgets, we're not addressing entitlement spending, we're not addressing tax expenditures. And I would think the lesson of history is pretty clear that you're not going to get a hold of your fiscal future unless you address those two elements of the budget. That is totally left out of our calculations. So we need a comprehensive budget agreement. Why is that so hard to figure out? We had one in 1990 on a bipartisan basis. We had one in 1993, Democratic heavy lifting alone. The result of all that, 4 years of balanced budgets, $400 billion of the national debt paid off, the kind of investments you're talking about, rather robustly funded, and the same on the domestic side. Now I'm not saying those agreements were politically popular. In fact, they were wildly unpopular, something for everybody to dislike. They included tax increases. They included entitlement cuts as well as controls on appropriated spending, but it worked. 4 years of balanced budgets and a roaring economy. We simply have not achieved that here because of the ideology that's taken hold of this institution. But we're not going to solve these budget woes otherwise, so we kind of dance around it, but that, I think, is the fact. And I just hope in the next administration, whoever it is, whatever it is, that we will revisit this need for a grand bargain, because until we do that, this is going to continue to be what we face. And patching it up isn't sufficient. Now, I took more time than I meant, but let me just ask about, and I'm following up here on the last member, the implication of some of these drawdown numbers. And Sergeant Major, I want to follow up specifically on what you're saying. The implication, and of course we know we want to take care of these men and women in uniform with the best medical care, the best mental health care, the best rehab that we can give them, particularly if they're injured in the service of our country. But I want you to put a finer point on it if you can. Does this mean that at any given time there's a significant percentage of the men and women that are technically considered active duty but for various reasons are unable to deploy? Is there any way to be more precise about that? Are they being counted in the overall in-strength figures? And then I guess you have to raise the question, too, about the incentive that these pressures create for the progress we've made in this medical care, in this mental health care, in this rehabilitation. Are there pressures to change that somehow? You say we assure every service member that we're with them for life, but there's no question in the short run anyway, there are these pressures that we need to contend with, and I'd appreciate your reflecting on how we deal with this.
Absolutely, sir. First, for the record, I'd like to say that those 110,000 soldiers may or may not have to transition, and each one of those soldiers has an individual medical concern that either temporarily or permanently disqualifies them for their deployment. And there's literally that many different cases, of which we deal with on an individual basis with our medical professionals. And our hope is, because we have invested in young men and women, is to make them healthy, get them healthy so they can deploy, fight, and win. But those do represent the total force structure, and they are part of our total number. So what we're doing, and we have a part of this too, is we're making significant changes to our medical care system so we can accurately track and address each one of those specific needs. And I can't talk about each one of the specific needs of them because they are all different. But I can assure you, those soldiers, that we do have to transition, and we may have to. And we're also going to have to transition about 14,000 this year who would otherwise like to stay due to the drawdown. We're going to provide them with the best care that we possibly can. And we're going to take care of their needs, as we have done, and as we have proven over the last 12 years of war.
Any of the others want to chime in on this issue?
I'd like to comment on that, sir. Our Commandant, Joe Neller, when you talk about the 7,000 or less that we have that's in that position. He's told the staff down at Quantico at our headquarters down there, Manpower Reserve Affairs, Training Education Command, Marine Corps Recruiting Command. Let's take a look at how we train both on when we're deployed forward and when we're back here in what most people know as a garrison life. So our physical fitness test, our combat fitness test, our weight standards, our obesity charts. He said, let's take an overall look at what we're doing in the pool of recruiting before they go to boot camp. Look at what we're doing in recruit training, how we train. Look at what we're doing to retain the Marines out here. He's looking at human performance optimization. We've come a long way, as you said, with medical care. And we're looking at everything from the things we put in our mouth to the machines we work out on in our gyms to the pack we carry on our back. Because some of those injuries are caused, by using equipment that's no longer, we've outgrown that equipment. We've outgrown it. And we have science that proves to us that we can train better. He's absolutely getting at that. And our numbers are coming down as he you know, tackles that problem. But it still remains the fact that the number of Marines we have drawing down to 182,000. When the Commandant says we need 186 to do the missions that you all have given us to do, and we go down to 182, that means our dwell time is not 1 to 2 or 1 to 3. It's 1 to 1 point something, which means, you know, quality of life. You got to come back and rest the force. The force, we came out of Afghanistan, Iraq, and we have 35,000 Marines forward deployed at any moment, 22,000 in the Pacific. I mean, if you want us to rest the force and become healthy, and that 100,000 and 7,000 to go away, a part of that is allowing us the time to rest, giving us the numbers that we need. The budget does not support that. It doesn't support that. So you got to rest the force in order to do that, and you got to modernize the force.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to recognize gentleman Mr. Joyce for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sergeant Major Green and Chief Cody, if you had something to maybe chime in on the credentialing aspect, that was one of the questions I wanted to address. I know that there was some response on one side. If you had anything else you want to say about that, I think it's important. I know at home, all across my district, there's employment to be had, and they're looking to employ veterans, and they want to make sure that we can make this transition as smooth as possible. If you had any ways that we could be helpful.
Yes,
I want to give you the opportunity to respond because you didn't have it.
Yes, sir. I'll be brief. It's a state-to-state, you know, conversation that needs to be had. You have some states like North Carolina where we have Camp Lejeune, you know, Marine Corps-based Camp Lejeune there. They've worked well. The state has worked well. Not every state really has an interest in this. We can't make states. They're your states. They're your constituents. You know, we can't make them come to the table. We absolutely invite them in forums like the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, hiring our heroes. You have individual organizations that come in. But that needs to be addressed at a state level. The states need to have some concerns about the military people that return to the states. They need to take an ownership in that. We have the military apprenticeship program, which we introduced to Marines within 30 days of joining their unit. They go to, you know, a class, 7 hours, and a part of that is introducing them to COOL, the credentialing websites, the map, you know, I just talked about. They're introduced to it up front. We're aligning the MOS, about 257 out of 300 military occupational specialties, with identifying all those credentialing items that we can do. So we're doing our part, sir. We just need the states to do their part.
Mr. Joyce, you know, so I'll kind of build on what Sergeant Major Green talked about. So the credentialing opportunities online has really been producing some positive results. So we have about 1,700 total licensures available. And in just in last year, we added a little over 900 to that. So we're making progress in the right way. I think where we could really use this body's help, so continued support within your states, but as a body, it's really how are we going to link up the DOD, Department of Labor, Veterans Affairs, and every one of these state organizations that deal with labor in those states. If we link these organizations together in a cohesive way, now you have this continuum of when we transition folks from the military through transition GPS, that these are all connected. The problem is there are opportunities out there for servicemen and women. They're very skilled. They're desirable. They have work ethic. They have experience. But every one of these entities work in their own way. And while we try to get the thread together, it's like it's by happenstance, it's by I knew somebody, we get a great rep that goes out there, does it, it works for a while. So if this body, I mean, and we did it, if you really want to use a model of how we did it with every one of the states, is we did it with the education. So we have every one of the states now that are acknowledging our military children that are moving from state to state and putting them in the same place. If we give that access, if we can work through the right legislation to give those agencies access to the information that they would need to know, they can reach right out to these great men and women that have served. So that's where I think the body can. I appreciate your efforts, and we're there. I mean, we want it, I mean, for sure, for the servicemen and women.
If I could just add, so.
I wanted to follow up because I think you had an opportunity, and they didn't have an opportunity, because I think this is very important. My father was a World War II vet who was shot and left for dead and believed it was his fate that brought him home. And, you know, you don't never talked about it with your kids, but as he was dying, you know, you're having these conversations, and you said to him, you know, what was it like? He said, you came home and you went to work. What the hell was there to talk about? You did your job and you came home and went to work. It's important we transition people to work, because it brings me to my next point, the high rates of suicide that we have among our veterans. And give you all an opportunity to discuss what it is that you're doing to help bring those numbers down and what we can do better to help facilitate the transition from active duty into civilian life.
So I'll begin, if that's okay with my counterparts here. But, you know, this year was a tough year for the United States Army. We actually saw an increase in suicides, and some of that was in our Guard and Reserves. And we've been working this very hard. So this is not go without a lot of effort put into this. Over the last few years, we've expanded our behavioral health teams to greater than we've ever seen in Army history. And we have embedded them down to unit level with 58 embedded behavioral health teams now to give that access and to break the stigma of seeking help for mental health. But I think where we can do more and where you can help us is getting that help out to our National Guard and Reserves. Of course, they have access to all the things when they live close to a military installation. But unfortunately, not all of our Guard Reserve soldiers do. They're dispersed throughout the United States, and we've seen a rise. And I believe that because of the efforts that we've done, we provided at our installations, and those people who are close on it and the active soldiers that live there have benefited from it. So I think that's an area that we can improve.
The Navy is increasing. We've got these teams called operational stress control teams, and they go out to our various units 6 months prior to deployment, and they sit down with the service members, the sailors, and talk to them about the stressors in life that unfortunately lead sometimes to suicide. And so we've recognized that we've seen some progress on that, so we've upped the ante. We're now funding more of these teams to go out to ensure that we're touching base with more of our service members. The numbers are a little bit elusive. I wouldn't say we had a good year. We had a better year than we had last year with regards to the numbers of suicides. But as soon as you say that, then, something changes and it's not as good the following year. So we're certainly not saying that we've achieved success. So we'll continue to work with these operational stress control teams. We'll continue to invest the resources that are necessary. We've identified some things that we believe oftentimes lead to suicide. And so we've got an initiative called Ask, Care, Treat. And then we have another initiative called, it's every sailor, every day, or one small act. It's making sure that no sailor feels like they're ever alone, because oftentimes in between these transition points, from training or duty stations, or when somebody has a life changing event, whether they get in trouble or lose a loved one, sometimes we forget that we need to spend time and pay attention to those people. And so we're making sure that we always have a hand on them, that we're always talking to them, and we make sure that we help walk them through these difficult times with this every sailor, every day, or one small act. So we're hopeful that we'll continue to see improvements, but time will tell.
So, sir, we have the Wounded Warrior Regiment, and that takes care of our wounded, ill, and injured. And they have programs like the DISC, the District Injury Support Coordinators, that are out in America in different areas. And they'll reach back, because the problem that we're seeing is how to close the gap on the millions that have served in the uniform. And they've come on with the ghosts, and we can't reach out and touch them. Mm-hmm. How do we close that gap? That's when we talk about state credentialing and tying all this together, the VA support necessary and the backlog there. All of this creates, suicide is the end state. It's getting at everything that makes someone feel that they're not worthy to live. It's all the programs, the quality of life that we're talking about here. The Commandant has the Marine for Life initiative. Marine for Life started in 2002. Everyone else adopted that from the Marine Corps. We still have that initiative going today with transition. We have to understand that there's a need to stay in contact when we say Marine for Life. We're trying to build this robust program to reach out and touch, to use our INIs, our recruiting stations out there, inspect instructor stations, everybody in the civilian world, the veterans organizations, public organizations, to reach out to these warriors. Because when they leave and they come out of their uniform, they go back into a world that doesn't understand where they've been. They have been working for Google and Facebook. They've been fighting combat. They've faced the enemy. And connecting that and understanding that, it's just, it's overwhelming sometimes. And it's not just that, you know, this year has been a bad year or that year has been a bad year. Every suicide. You know, you see the spike in kids in the military committing suicide. Dependents. I mean, that's a quality of life that someone feel like they don't rate. That's where we are with it, with getting that suicide.
Thank you, Sergeant Major Green. And let me go to Ms. Lee for 5 minutes. Recognize her.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and to our ranking member. I apologize for being late. I was at a meeting at the White House, but I really wanted to get back to say thank you, first of all, for your service and for being here today. Just a little bit about a personal note on quality of life. My dad was a lieutenant colonel, 25 years in the Army, stationed at Fort Bliss. And in the day, Fort Bliss was the only place that I could go to a restaurant because of segregation. It was the only place I could go to a swimming pool. It was the only place we could live in a house during that period. That was a really lovely house. And so I just want to say quality of life issues, just coming from the daughter of a veteran. I remember the day when the Army provided the quality of life for my family that we otherwise would not have had. And so thank you very much. A couple of things I want to raise just in terms of PTSD. My background is psychiatric social work, and I'm really concerned about an article that I read in the New York Times. Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to put this in the record and ask Sergeant Major Dailey about this. And I want to just read a bit from this article. This has to do with Christopher Goldsmith, was discharged from the Army at the height of the Iraq War in the hospital after attempting suicide. After coming home, on his first deployment, his duties were photographing mutilated corpses. After coming home, he was stalked by nightmares and despair. In 2007, he overdosed on pills, and his platoon found him passed out in a grove tree, in a grove of trees at Fort Stewart, Georgia, that had been planted to honor soldiers killed in combat. Now, instead of screening Mr. Goldsmith for post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, the records show that the Army wrote him up for missing his flight, then forced him out of the military with a less than honorable discharge. When he petitioned the Army to upgrade his discharge, arguing that he missed his flight because of undiagnosed PTSD, it rejected his appeal. Years since, he's appealed twice more for an honorable discharge and been denied both times. So how are you looking at discharges as it relates to dishonorable discharges, for example, that occur when really it's PTSD that's service-related, and there does not seem to be the system in place that will allow the veterans or the personnel to really, you know, have the benefit of the doubt and argue the case that whatever took place was as a result of a service-connected PTSD?
Yes, absolutely. And I'd
like to put this on the record. Without objection, it will be.
And Congressman Lee, I can't talk of the specifics of the nature of the article you referred to. I'd, you know, have to take that for the record, so I can't talk of specifics, but I can talk of the specifics of what we're doing now and the specifics of the nature of the issue that you're talking about. So first and foremost, the Army takes behavioral health and the injury to our soldiers very seriously. I'm among those men and women that have deployed for 5 years to combat, and I take it very seriously. So firsthand, I know the experiences. Firsthand, I know the challenges associated with looking and doing the things that you described that young man had to do in combat, and I can assure you this leader is critically focused on the health and the welfare of our young men and women. I'm also responsible for their discipline. So I understand that we have to balance the care of our soldiers, but I also have to ensure that this nation is protected by men and women who are members of the profession, uphold standards at all times, and they represent and are held to a higher standard of the people that they are paid to protect. So it is a delicate balance. But what I can assure you, before any soldier, now that is discharged, they are carefully reviewed, especially if they have behavioral health, by both the medical professional and the chain of command to ensure that all their medical benefits, health needs are met, and that there's not a confrontation between the indiscipline and the behavioral health problems they have. I can report that in 2015, less than 1% of the people who were discharged had PTSD. So I can tell you, I can assure you that we are taking care of our soldiers. And we're reviewing each one of the cases that were alluded to in a recent article, around 22,000 of them that were discharged with behavioral health issues. And the Secretary of the Army, the Acting Secretary of the Army, will release that review here very shortly.
So you're reviewing those to look at possible other factors, such as PTSD, that could have been responsible for a dishonorable discharge?
We are.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that's very important to get on the record also, because that's a lot of, those are a lot of people.
They are a lot of people, yes,
you know,
I agree.
And
they are our soldiers.
And they're soldiers.
They're
that's right.
Soldiers,
and they deserve this. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Lee.
Mr. Chairman, may I just interject something?
Absolutely.
Back a few years ago, the Surgeon General of the Army came back with a report to the Defense Subcommittee that basically concluded that any soldier that was deployed in theater for a minimum of 2 weeks had some incidents of PTSD.
Congressman, I'm not familiar with that.
That was the conclusion that was reached. So every deployed service member is likely to have some degree of PTSD. Some is greater than others. So the impact on conduct that Ms. Lee is referring to in that article is very serious, because you know, in our casework, we have applications to review all the time, and we are submitting that. And if the folks who are doing the review have been there for a while and are not fully familiar with the impact of PTSD, that will result in a denial when it probably is actually service-related and probably should be upgraded, the discharges.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop. This time I'd like to recognize Mr. Fortenberry for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, good morning. Pleasure to see you all. Thanks so much for your service. Thanks so much for your enthusiasm. The chairman and I were sharing a comment a moment ago, and it really, the heart of it is this. Where does the strength of America come from? We don't reflect on that a whole lot. We really don't. And it doesn't come out of Washington policymakers. We should be reflective of that strength. It comes from values and how our values form. They're formed in family life and faith life and through institutions that have solid tradition, that have a vision, that have a mission, that are self-sacrificial in nature, leading our minds and hearts to the higher things. You represent that. You're one of the few institutions left in the country, frankly, with the pervasive effect of bringing people to a set of values that has deep meaning and purpose. So I want to thank you for your sacrifice. In that regard, what we're talking about is absolutely essential. How do we keep soldiers, Marines, airmen, air personnel for life, being part of that military family and upholding this great tradition? So I want to walk through a series of questions with you, but first I want to commend Mr. Jolly, my colleague, for what he did in Florida. I am very interested in this. I think we had a conversation last year in the hallway, and
we
talked about some of the dynamics in Nebraska. I want to make sure we're harmonizing everything with your transitional programs. So can you come?
I will, sir.
Okay.
I will.
Perfect. We'll set that up with you. We've got certain Department of Labor programs for veterans in the state. Many businesses very interested and acclimated toward hiring veterans. Several universities doing different things. I just want to make sure it's harmonized, that we're all pulling in the same direction and effectively leveraging it.
And if I could make a statement to that, ladies and gentlemen, when you help us in these efforts, it makes a difference. It makes a difference. It's a stand that our civil leaders support the things that we're doing, and it literally makes a difference. When Congressman Jolly comes to events like that, he brings people and people listen, because you are their representatives. So I appreciate if each one of you could find time to highlight, come see the great things our soldiers do. And I know many of you already do, but I would appreciate if you could do that, because it does advance our efforts, our collective efforts to take care of our service members.
Well, let's figure out a pathway to get that done. This issue of transition is so critical to the well-being of so many people. I want to explore a little bit this issue of credentialing. I think you talked extensively about it. I assume all branches have this process, but what exactly does that mean? I don't want to spend too much time on it. But again, how that's harmonized, or is the credentialing itself in the military actually being seen by employers as a new standard that meets acceptable general standards that come out of academia or other institutions? Let me put them all on the table, and then you can address these as we go through. I don't want my time to run out. TRICARE for life. In the current health care construct, children can stay on their parents' health care bill till 26. That's not the case in TRICARE, as I understand it. Is that correct?
25 until if they're going to school.
If they're full-time students.
If they're full-time students, they can be continued to carry on until that.
So that's the stipulation?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Is that an issue in term? I think somebody, well, the point ought to be is I think somebody ought to do the analysis on this, because I didn't vote for the current health care bill. I need to make that clear. But one of the aspects of it that I think is reasonable is keeping children on the parental health care plan longer, and it actually may end up saving the entire system money. Younger people are healthier, replenishes pools. So I think it would be interesting to see if this could be an enhancement of the quality of life issue for families and actually save some money. So if there's a possibility of any of you could analyze that. Is your recruitment strong? And then, Sergeant Major Green, you referenced the military resale system as a significant employer of military families, and I want to learn more about that.
You say the resale system, sir?
Yes, in your testimony.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I assume that's commissaries.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. That, you know, the Military Compensation Retirement Modernization Commission had an initiative in there to join commissaries with exchanges. The value of our commissaries, of course, is the savings. You know, people may live, Marines and families may live somewhere far from the base because that's where they choose to live, but they absolutely shop at the commissary. The resale value of getting the goods where they need to go, overseas, and what we're going through with commissaries not being successful, not producing enough to keep the doors open. The Marine Corps is a program, just the Marine Corps alone, has Marine Corps community services. It's tied to our exchanges. If we join...
That's a brilliant idea.
Sir?
That's a brilliant idea.
Well, to join them together?
Well, I don't have the working vocabulary that
yes,
you have, so I'm generally following.
Community services?
Yes.
Yes, sir. We're the only ones that have that. MWR is encased in that. Marine Corps Community Service is tied to an exchange.
Try not to use acronyms. I
yes,
know
sir.
It's tough
yes,
in
sir.
The military.
Yes, sir.
But.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Marine Corps Community Services right. are tied to exchanges. And the exchange system for us produces a profit to make up in child care funding.
But again, think about that Marine for life,
yes,
the tie of the family, giving people opportunity and proximity to where their loved one is, participating in the mission. I've actually also proposed expanding commissary benefits for veterans.
Yes, sir.
You could start with disabled veterans. I'd like for you all to entertain that oh, yeah. that prospect. And I have more, Mr. Chairman. My time's up, so I'll come back to it later.
We can go in the second round of questioning here. Obviously, we're not voting until I think closer to 11:30, so we can try to go through this second round or until votes are called, whatever comes first. So I just have a few more questions I wanted to get into as we're talking about quality of life issues. It's been a very interesting discussion. I think Sergeant Major Green, you said at one point during the discussion this morning, you talked about individual readiness, unit readiness, and family readiness. I
yes,
think
sir.
It's what you had said, and I think all other branches concur. But do you, and this is open to any of you, do you track the rate of foreclosures? I want to get into housing. Foreclosures among military homeowners. And are you hearing of any service members who have a permanent change of station and are unable to sell their homes at their prior stations? Are you hearing anything about this? I'm just curious, you know, how this economy is affecting recruitment, retention. How's it affecting your ability to
yes,
sell
sir.
Homes when you have to move about? So if anybody wants to take a stab at that.
I'll take the first stab, sir, since you highlighted my name.
Yeah.
You know, in the height of the war, in the beginning, when the bubble burst in 08 and before,
mm-hmm.
that was a huge problem because we were, you know, permanent change station, PCSing Marines at the same rate. Once we began to understand that, we began to work with the monitors more and talk about what financial situation families are in. And that's really what it comes down to, sir. It comes down to leaders knowing their people, knowing the Marines and their families, the Marines trusting that the leaders have their best welfare, their best mm-hmm. interests at heart, and that when you see someone in that situation, you're going to provide an avenue that's going to make them most successful. Not just permanent change of stations just to be doing it or it's your turn to go. we have to stop and actually realize that that's a human being, a family that's making a move. And we've closed that gap tremendously, sir.
Well, thank you. Is it any other services want to chime in on that?
I think I would disagree with Sergeant Major Green. We had a significant issue with that, you know, when the housing boom kind of fell out, and there was some legislations that were passed that provided some relief for service men and women and their families. So I don't want to say it's not an issue at all. It's just not the issue it was.
Okay, so it's better than it had been, but
yes, sir.
It was.
It's just better. It's there.
Yeah, it's there. Yes, it's not as bad as it was a few years back, yes, but okay. Now I'm going to probably get into some dangerous territory here because I'm going to ask you to speak for your spouses, some of whom are here today. And it really has to do with this, you know, we're talking about family readiness. Do you track the employment rates among military spouses? And are those rates going down? Or are you hearing anecdotal evidence of a lot of military spouses losing their jobs? So I'm asking you to speak for your spouses, but hey, I wouldn't object to them chiming up for themselves. If they have any anecdotal evidence, what are you hearing on that front?
I'll go first, sir. Yeah. So my wife, she's a registered nurse, mm-hmm, and every state has a licensing process. I honestly think it's a money racket because medicine doesn't change. Medicine doesn't change from state to state. So why should she have to license? And she sit on some of these military boards and voice this. Why should she have to relicense when we move from California to Virginia? I mean, what is that all about? And we're doing that to families, you know, all around the nation, and the employment rate. You know, spouse transition is available also. STARS, Spouse Transition Assistance and Readiness. Within the transition program, STARS is built in there. And the Marine Corps, we utilize that. Not only for transitioning spouses, but we have programs for spouses to, once they check into the installation, they can go right away and get that help from Marine Corps Community Services. That unique thing that we have. So we do visit that, sir. We don't track per number, but we offer every family that opportunity to have that knowledge.
So,
please. I'd just like to make a comment on the impact of what you just described has on our soldiers and their families. Like you mentioned, I don't believe we do, but I'll check for the record. I'll take that for the record if we track spouse employment rates. What I can tell you, though, is that's a factor in what we all describe for our young soldiers, sailors, and airmen, marine as they do PCS. The American family does have a little bit more of a luxury than what our soldier, sailors, and airmen do, and that's stability. It's able to capitalize on things like buying a home, you know, being able to have a spouse's career and not having to move around all the time. And these are the challenges. We assume ourselves, and we sign up to do this. But it's a factor. Those are the factors. Those are the hidden compensation things that we don't compensate soldiers for. It's called equity. Equity in a home. Equity in a community. Equity in a soccer team. Equity in a spouse's career, because many American families today, both household members do work. And it's a challenge, I can tell you, just from my spouse moving around and even working in the DOD, it's a tough challenge. At nobody's fault but our own, because we chose this lifestyle. And Congress has done a lot to help us with that in the past, but I think that we should take a look at that, because there's an area here where I think we can help with things like licensing and making them equal across all states, not just nursing. We've done a lot of work there, but same thing for credentialing for our spouses. And our Soldier for Life transition centers are also open up to our spouses in the Army, too, as well.
Yeah, Mr. Bishop.
Mr. Chairman, would you, for just a moment, I just want to make sure that you're aware of the Congressional Military Family Caucus and our partnership with the First Ladies Initiative and with Blue Star Families that does a survey every year. And we just released a survey about a month ago on the needs of military families and spousal employment and credentialing for spouses as well as for transitioning service members is a big issue. And we have been actively involved in that, trying to get uniform laws passed by state legislatures so that those licenses will be transferable. I mean, it's not just nurses. You got cosmetologists. You got insurance people, real estate folks,
commercial lawyers, commercial licenses, truck drivers.
So, Chairman Jim, just so we actually do have the Military Spouse Employment Partnership, which is exactly what Congressman Bishop is talking about from the White House. A huge program that is, it really has produced great results since June of 11. Honestly, the program was kind of put into place. So we have, you know, a little less than 300 companies that are partnered with that. We do track those numbers, meaning how many people our spouses have been matched, right, you know, to those jobs. And then we have the spouse education opportunity where they get that credentialing online. So there's some great effort there. But to the Sergeant Major's, both Sergeant Major's point, there's still a gap there. The gap is, as we move them, it takes time. Sometimes they're not long enough to get there. Sometimes they know we're not going to be there long enough to hire them, right? You're not going to be in the neighborhood that long. So there's effort here that is producing some pretty significant results when you think about how many people have been hired. You know, over 547,000 jobs posted out there. You know, that's pretty good program to have available to our spouses. We just have to continue to link that with every state and those opportunities.
Master Sergeant, I'm going to recognize Mr. Bishop for 5 minutes. Before I do, I was going to mention that I'm notified that we may have votes as early as 11:10, maybe as late as 11:25. So, you know, we'll do 5 minutes each, but try to keep your questions as quick as possible and your responses as short as you can make them. So thank you. Mr. Bishop, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, you asked about the foreclosures and I think the Sergeant Major referred to the PCSing. We did have a program called the Homeowners Assistance Program,
yes,
which was utilized quite a bit during the heat of yes, deployments, where there were PCSs and families were moved where they had a mortgage and they moved from one side of the country, one side of the country to the other, or wherever, and had a home that was not sold and had two mortgages, and this program was made available to assist the service members. And it's my understanding that we've sort of downsized, if not closed that out now. And of course, so I thought it was an interesting question to find out if there's still a need for it. But that was one of the elements of assistance that families could get.
Yes, sir.
And of course, they were severely penalized, even more so than civilian families.
Yes, sir.
When the bubble hit, so that's I think a very important issue, and of course the Congressional Military Family Caucus is involved with that. But let me shift gears for a moment and ask Sergeant Major Green and Sergeant Major Dailey to talk about the issue of women in combat. The Secretary of Defense, I think, has sort of made it clear that women will be eligible for all combat jobs. The Army, I think, has pretty much moved forward with that. There's been some resistance on the part of the Marine Corps. The Commandant, of course, has to comply, but there's been somewhat of a concern. And so I wish I could get both of you to address it. I attended the graduation of the first two women from the Ranger School at Fort Benning. Everybody was very, very proud of their service, and their colleagues felt like they were just as prepared as any other Ranger who ever finished the Ranger School. I understand that the Marine Corps had some difficulty with the individual officer's course graduation for some women, and has sort of put a hold on that. So could I get you to address that? Because obviously it impacts career promotion and progression.
Yes, sir.
And we really would like for that to be equal opportunity in all of these areas.
Yes, sir.
If I could.
Go ahead. I'll just come up. Go ahead.
So the Army started this several years ago, and we invested in it heavily to do the research analysis and to create one situation, make every organization and every job in the Army open on standards based, irregardless of gender, race, religion, sexual preference, anything. I think that we've done a phenomenal job of doing just that. 50% of our nation is women. I think it would be an injustice to offer or close anything that someone wanted to do and was physically able to do. And we've proved through our research analysis that there are women that can and are willing to fight in our combat arms. And I'm confident, and the chief has tasked me to make sure that we maintain standards in those organizations, because at the end of the day, this is about readiness. This is about readiness of our soldiers being able to fight and win our nation's wars. And I can assure you that the standards are and will be
maintained. As you saw, outside, representing us outside Fort Benning door to there, those fine women who graduated Ranger School met and achieved the standard.
Sir, the Secretary of Defense gave us marching orders on the 1st of January. All MOSs will open up, and they're the six final load-bearing MOSs, ground combat MOSs, they're open as well. When I came in a year ago, this conversation was at this heated moment. Talked to the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of the Navy. Wasn't about keeping women, you know, out of those MOSs. First, let me say for the record, this conversation is not about women in combat. Women have been in combat for a long time. And when you say that, women feel offended because we've had numerous women die in the uniform in combat. The conversation is about those MOSs, those load-bearing ground combat MOSs that are the toughest ones. The standards are tough. The only thing we ask is that we do not change the standards. We've had women go to infantry officers course, not officer candidate school. Women are there. So you have to go there to see the difference in the two. There's a lot of conversation going on, but very few people have visited. I don't think anybody in the room has visited every recruit training of all the services except myself. And if one of you all have done it, correct me. So I've seen firsthand over the last 3 months how everyone trains. Let me tell you, when you say Marine Corps, be most ready when the nation's least ready, and we put a standard to something, do you want to change the standard is the question. Because if no female gets through IOC, because it's available, but do you like the product that we're producing on this end right now? If you like that product, then you're not going to tell us to change the standard. Are you going to challenge the standard is the question. Why would you challenge the standard? Because challenging the standard would get at making it an even fight. Those six MOSs is open now. Any woman can come into it. But here's how it works. In order to put a private, an E1, into infantry, the load-bearing MOS, the Marine that looks in, kicks the door in, looking to be killed, it's not about the woman. It's about making sure the 7% of the female Marines we have are successful, that we maintain 7% or more. Because if you throw them in right now on day one, the average male Marine recruit in boot camp can do 12 pull-ups when they hit the yellow footprints on day one. The average female American that goes to recruit training can do 0 to 1. That's the average. Our question, our what we wanted was time to study and make sure we're setting all Marines up for success and that we're not touching, you know, combat readiness or effectiveness. Mm-hmm. So in saying that, we raised the ground combat element integrated task force. We're the only service that took the time to study this because we have the most to lose. We have the most to lose in this because we have six MOSs that have never been opened up to women. You can't just say throw them in there. You got to have a cadre of senior enlisted and officers to be there when they get there. Now, here's what the female Marines say. For the most part, the ones that are serving now, wait a minute. Why are you changing this? Because we have, when I'm talking about infantry right now, 03, the one that we asked not to open, along with combat engineers. We just give Marines orders to those MOSs. They go to the battalion level. They put on the pack 100 plus pounds, and they march 25 miles to get tested for combat readiness. Those are all males. Those are all males. We want to know the effect. What effect is that going to have on a female? Physiologically and biologically, we're different, and no one in this room can do anything about that. We have to have time to study that. So the Ground Combat Integrated Task Force, we submitted that. A lot of people didn't listen to it. We can break it, but let's not break it. Give us the time to get it right, is what the commander has asked.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you that because I wanted to give you an opportunity to give that explanation.
Yes, sir.
And I appreciate that very much because none of us wants to change the standards. We want Marines to be Marines, regardless of gender. But I wanted you to have the opportunity to give that explanation as to the difference between the Ranger training, the Marine Individual Officers Corps, and why it is that the Marine Corps has had some concern.
Ranger, if I could just say so, Ranger is, you can be in the Army and go to be a Ranger. You can come in as, you know, in the process, the fight accessions. In the Marine Corps infantry, that's a military occupation especially,
yeah.
That you're going to live the rest of your life. Yeah. They're two totally different things.
This is a very interesting discussion, I must say. And I know, too, that a lot of our soldiers and Marines and others coming back from war zones come back with musculoskeletal issues. You know, you mentioned carrying a lot of weight, and it's a conversation we're going to have to continue to have here. Given the time restraints, I'm going to ask that we go 2.5 minutes each, if that's okay with each of the members. So I'm going to recognize Mr. Valadeo, then Mr. Price, Jolly, and then Joyce.
Okay. Well, we'll have some questions for the record.
Oh, I mean, this, you'll get there.
Obviously, there's a lot of very important issues. One that I know was touched on while I was gone, commissaries, they play a huge role, and so I'm going to want to know what each one of the branches can do, understanding that location in difference to as far as rural, how close they are to communities and shopping and things like that, and how much of a role that plays to our enlisted, our soldiers, our sailors, pockets. I mean, this is something that affects their daily lives and the resources that they're given. Another one, I had the honor to actually visit Iraq and Kuwait over Christmas and spend quite a bit of time with some of our troops. And one of the things that was brought up was the ability to contact their homes, their families via internet. And a lot of them are relying on local services, and I understand the need to conserve resources and not put a huge infrastructure in place to provide internet. But it was something that I found very interesting, and obviously quality of life for these folks and being able to communicate. And one of the things I did find interesting was that quite a few folks had the opportunity to reach out and actually wish their families Merry Christmas and throughout the holidays. And that's something that does play a huge role. But this one, again, because I have the honor of representing Lemoore Naval Air Station, is something that's very near and dear, and I hear about it quite a bit. Just in the last 2 weeks, I had a few teletown halls, and it came up in both. And it has to do with the hospital there at Lemoore. And when I was out on the USS Ronald Reagan, again, I had a chance to talk to just a few sailors by myself and get an idea of what they're struggling with. And a lot of the issues that were brought up today were brought up as well. But the hospital is one that they all nodded their head in agreement with and is a very big deal to a lot of those folks. And I'd like to ask Master Chief Petty Officer Stevens about what's going on there. I know that they've cut back on the emergency room services and delivering of children, maternity ward. And I know it's no longer 24-hour service, but as things are changing, as the base is growing, what are the opportunities there to serve these and to make sure that as our guys are deployed, they know that their spouses and their families are being taken care of with the hospital there on the base? And if anybody else wants to add to that at the end, happy to take it.
Well, as the size of the base or the capacity with the Joint Strike Fighter coming in, as that changes and the populations increase, there's always the opportunity to revisit and see what's the, you know, the best application of the hospital there in Lemoore. The hospital itself has great capacity. What they're trying to do right now is balance the cost and the proficiency aspect with the doctors and the nurses and the technicians. So if you was to fully staff that hospital with its capacity or its capability, the doctors, the nurses, and the technicians there wouldn't get the sets and the reps that they need to maintain the proficiency that's necessary for them. So what they do is they load share with the hospital out in town. So some of the emergency room services, child delivery, and things like that, folks can do some of that out in town, and they can do some of it on the base. So that way they're able to have the right number of patients coming through to maintain proficiency for the doctor. You wouldn't want to have, you know, a heart surgeon that does, you know, one open heart surgery, you know, every 6 months be your heart surgeon. And so what you got to do is make sure that you find the right balance between the capacity of the hospital and the number of patients that are coming through. But again, as the hospital, because the hospital has that capacity, we bring more people in there. All they got to do is start plugging in more doctors and nurses and technicians, and they're able to sustain the necessary care. So just trying to find the right balance between cost, capacity, and doctor capability.
Just for the record, my nephew was born at that hospital, so So it's actually something that's very personal. So again, thank you, Chairman. We will have some questions for the record. So thanks for your service.
Thank you, Mr. Valdez. Let's go to Mr. Farr now for 2.5 minutes. Yeah, we're going to be voting any time.
Well, next. Thank you, everybody. I thought I'd just tell the committee a true story about going and seeing at Walter Reed to the rehab center there with my brother-in-law, who was trying to talk to military. My brother-in-law is totally disabled, but he's launched a disability golf and trying to get accessible carts on military golf courses. And we ran into a wounded warrior coming back from Middle East in a wheelchair named Tammy Duckworth. She came running, came into the room, just lit up, you know, like everybody says, wait till she comes in. And so I was asking her, I said, well, here she is. She said, I guess you want to know how I lost my legs. It's trying to, you know, bring a helicopter down. I couldn't figure out why my feet didn't work. And she said, because I didn't know it, I lost my legs, but I was able to land it. I said, well, what happens now? And she said, well, yeah, I'm going to get my prosthetics, and I'm going right back. So I asked the officer standing next to her, he said, is that possible? He said, if she can, she's going back, she wants to go back to be an instructor, not go back to as a warfighter. He said, if she can pass all of the requirements, all the physical requirements, she can go back. She didn't pass them. She's now a congresswoman. So unintended consequences. Anyway, I just want to thank all of you for your service. And particularly, you know, we have a tradition in this committee where we certainly listen to the combatant commanders and everybody else at the high rank. But I think this is one of our favorite moments of these hearings to really listen to the enlisted, the men and women of our services and what you do for them. You speak the voice of the community, and I really appreciate that. So I just want to, I do think, in all due respect, we need to also, as we defend the needs for these benefits, we also need to sort of be proud of them. And I don't think we should be afraid of telling people, look, you're going to service, you got these. And the private sector ought to own up to this stuff. America right now, and this is, I'm just really worried about it, this whole discontent that is showing itself. And of all, who are the most popular candidates out there? The ones that are dissing government. Well, military is a big part of government. So if you're dissing all of it, you're going to be dissing all the members of that family. And we have got to do a better job, us as politicians, of selling the benefits of government rather than just saying that government is the problem. And I think you are role models for helping us sell it well. Thank you.
Let me recognize Mr. Jolly for 2.5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the MCPON, I'm going to give the floor to you to make your best case here. I know your strong concern over single sailor housing. You mentioned it in your testimony. We've talked about it as well. What does this committee need to attend to? In a perfect world, as best as we could, given limited resources, how can we do better for the young men and women in the Navy for single sailor housing?
Well, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, and I need to be clear because I've had discussions with the Navy's most senior leaders, and they know my passion on the single sailor housing. And they said, MCPON, as you talk about this, please don't ask people to ask us to move money from operational accounts
I understand.
To
we
the
understand.
Housing account, right?
Right.
And so, again, this is something, if we don't address it now, it's going to be a huge problem later. So roughly 50%, just slightly less than 50% of our single sailor housing is inadequate right now. And the pace in which we're recapitalizing and building new facilities is in no way keeping up with what's necessary. I just think we have to really take a hard look at this and what we're going to do in the future, because otherwise we're going to wake up and we're going to have a bill that it's impossible to pay. And I would submit that that's probably going on with all of the services to one level or another.
Yeah.
We've been moving money out of our shore infrastructure to our operational accounts out of necessity. And if we continue to do that, we're going to be hurting, and these shore infrastructures play a vital role to our operational readiness. It may not be the alligator closest to the canoe, but it certainly plays a vital role. So we need to take a hard look at that in the future.
So 50% inadequate. Describe in 30 seconds inadequate. Mm-hmm. Convey to us what designates single sailor housing as inadequate.
Well, so DOD's goal is that 90% of all the housing, and I forget the date, I think it's 2018, but 90% of all the single sailor or all the single service member housing should be at 80% on a scale from 0 to 100%. And so right now, 50% of our housing is below that 80%. We used to do it differently. I'm not sure why they changed it. I think it's kind of semantics, but we used to do it in a condition of readiness, and 1 and 2 were considered to be livable, and 3 was kind of livable, and 4 was inhabitable. So I would say that, you know, probably 70% or below, you're getting close to the inhabitable level. And so we're nowhere near where we need to be right now.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Recognize Mr. Price for 2.5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sergeant Major, in using an illustration from the Army, I'm not just focusing on the Army, nor am I asking you to comment on the specific case, but I think to ask this question quickly, I can use an illustration from Fort Bragg. There have in recent years been very promising discussions about the way that the plans of the Army, the housing plans, the educational plans, might dovetail with some of the needs of the local community. There's, for example, been a focus on possible infill housing as opposed to just going farther and farther out into adjacent counties. That would obviously have a great impact on the city of Fayetteville as well as meet the Army's needs. There's been a good bit of talk about the secondary education needs and the way that those objectives might come together. I have to say that with the proposed drawdown and with the budget uncertainty, those discussions have also taken on an air of uncertainty and have been pushed into a more distant future. I raise that just to raise the broader question of that level of community cooperation and synergy with respect to military installations. I wonder if you have anything to report about particularly creative examples of how this has worked, and I wonder here too about the consequences, perhaps unintended consequences, of the drawdown.
Congressman Price, I think I can represent my fellow service members well, as we have taken a large chunk of the drawdown in our active force, which, as you know, major installations across our Army are not just installations. They're members of the community, and we like to think that way because my family was raised by them little hometown Americas outside those Army gates. We have many families that live and work out there. As you know, as we draw down the Army to historic lows, as I've mentioned before, this doesn't just affect our readiness. It affects American people in many ways. And we always want to partner with our communities because we want them to feel like that is their Army base. Security reasons, we've had to close our gates and heighten security, and that's a necessity for the safety of our soldiers and our family members. But it is a toll. It's a toll we feel from our partners outside our gates, as we hear it all the time. It's a huge concern, as you know. And it's something that I think we're going to have to continue to contend with in the future. Hopefully we won't have to make further cuts and further decisions. But I can tell you, firsthand, to answer your question, is we hear of great concern from our communities outside our gates.
I'm not sure I'm understanding your answer. I understand. I believe these security concerns, but I'm asking about these joint planning and exercises with local communities, and in particular the kind of synergy we've begun to see with respect to housing and education decisions.
Sir, I don't have the specifics on any joint ventures outside of our installations. Of course, I could take that for the record.
So, Congressman, I could maybe offer up a little bit. So we're certainly doing it with some of the charter schools, and we're allowing charter schools to be built on our installations, which is good for the members that live and reside on the installations or in the immediate community. It's also good for the community because children from those old communities are able to attend those schools to fill them out. So we're doing that. We're also doing some ventures where I use Nellis just as an example, and Las Vegas, where the community actually built our gym there. because it was something that we were not going to be able to get within the budget to be able to sustain. They built that gym for us that helped with, no kidding, not just the military men and women, but the civilians that live in the communities that work on that installation, and they were able to do that, and then turn that back over to the Department of Defense. So there are certain some synergies that are taking place in doing just what you say, building housing communities closer to the base at fixed cost, right? They're targeted at certain demographics of income. So they let that income of military members reside there, as well as the local populace. So it's a dual-headed thing. So there's a lot of effort there. We call it a P4 initiative in the Air Force, so these private-private party partner type of things. So I think there's a lot of growth potential there to help support the communities as well as support the military.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. This time, I'm going to recognize Mr. Joyce for 2.5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Recognizing that access to care, quality medical care is an important objective, certainly hear a lot about it on the VA end of it. How is it in the different services, and what are we doing to make sure that our people are receiving the highest quality care? So one can answer for all, or all can answer for one, whatever, however you want to address that, but it's sort of an open-ended question.
So I think that we provide tremendously great health care to our military members in the service. That doesn't mean it's not challenging to get the type of care they need depending on where you're at. So if we have military treatment facilities thereby with the right type of resources, that's obviously a better scenario for our military members and families. But it goes to the retirees also. It goes to the extended a footprint of TRICARE, and then the limitations that are placed on the various TRICARE programs on how they can access this care. So I would arguably say we do really good, but I think the demand signal is actually on the increase. When you think about all the costs of war and the men and women that have served over the last 25 years that are leaving, and now some of that care is coming home to roost, I think there's a desire by all of the services, and we put this in the budget, that we want to draw more care back to the military treatment facilities and less out into the networks, only because we need that for the readiness of those no kidding medical care providers. Right, we need them to be trained and ready to go and keep their skills up, but it's also important that we have good access and good ability to use a network and have referral capabilities and not make it so painful, right? So it's it can be very difficult for family members to get the care that they need if it's not available or there's not room at an MTF.
I was going to Congressman Joyce and Congressman Valadeo, both of you bring up good points when it comes to military medicine. I think it's important that as Chief Cody just mentioned, as we look at ways to save monies and reduce costs of military medicine, that we don't overreach and start counting too much on the civilian sector, both inside the states and really outside the states is where it really can become concerning, because it can impact readiness without really knowing about it until it's too late. Something happens and you need that capability, and that capability doesn't exist because you've been using capabilities out in the economy for so long. To reconstitute that could be very difficult. So there is a balance, and I know that our professional medical folks in DOD are taking a close look at that, but I think it's something we all need to pay attention to.
I believe it's critical because there's been recommendation, as we know, about our medical care. And it's critical to state that, I agree, we do need to fix access to care. I hear that as concern from our soldiers and family members in many places I travel. But also, we have to maintain our medical treatment facilities. It's a readiness issue for us and for all the services, because that's where our doctors receive the critical skills they need to be able to fight and win. I mean, we're going to need that medical care forward, and they have to be able to practice that medicine back here, and our families benefit from that expert care.
And I just want to address also on this issue is that I believe Sergeant Major Green brought up the nurses having a problem with credentialing. I'm the co-chair of the nursing caucus, and we're going to work on that for you, as well as other credentialing issues.
All the credentialing. Appreciate that, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm out of time.
Can I comment on that, Mr. Chairman?
Sure.
What we're doing in our district right now, I hope the whole committee will come out and see, we're building the first joint clinic with DOD and VA. And this committee ought to really pay attention to these, because we're the only committee in Congress. The Senate doesn't have anything. We take care of soldiers from essentially cradle to the grave, because we have all the veterans authorities in this committee. And I think this jointness, particularly between DOD and VA, needs to be really pushed. But that clinic is the way we're going to get quality of care for everybody.
Yeah, it's a good point, Mr. Farr, that as we
You know, I often talk about doing a better job integrating the veterans and the civilian health systems. We also have to talk about doing a better job integrating the veterans and the DOD health systems.
No, Mr. Chairman, I will second Mr. Farr's motion that we should do that as a group.
Yeah.
That was such a motion.
Well, we are the Appropriations Committee. It's not always our role to set policy, although we'd like to from time to time. So this time I'd like to recognize Mr. Fortenberry for 2.5 minutes, and sounds like we have a few-minute reprieve on the vote.
Oh,
there it goes.
Nope.
Go ahead.
There
so go ahead. We're good.
I'll hurry. Nobody told me it wasn't our job to set policy.
Set policy from the authorizing committees, okay. And a little less from the Appropriations Committee. Right. We all set policy.
So, gentlemen, I gave you a quick list of things. Perhaps you can look at the issue of the TRICARE question that I talked about, get back to us, just in a cursory manner, just as an initial blush. The two other things, though, the potential expansion of commissary benefits to veterans, maybe those who are disabled. I have proposed this. It gets hung up here and there. I want to put that back on the table. I also have another bill that I want you to consider and potentially help with. It's called the Veterans Transitional Entrepreneurial Transition Act. Now, what this does, it creates a pilot program whereby veterans who are prepared because of their skill sets that they've obtained in the military, who are not in a position or do not need to use GI benefits for college, because the original intent of the GI Bill is transition.
Yes.
And that generally is interpreted as higher education. But there are a lot of, or potentially a lot of, members of the military who have a sufficient set of skills that could move directly into small business on their own. This would provide a pilot project to see how the government could facilitate the upfront capital cost and, again, expand the number of veterans who are able to leverage their GI Bill benefits, and many do not. So I propose that to you. I've talked to numerous veterans groups about this. We continue to sensitize everyone to the potential here, and we've gotten a lot of great feedback, one exception, but we're still working on that. I'd like you to, again, in your analysis and thinking, see how this would integrate successfully, starting with pilot programs. We test it to make sure that this is functional. So that's what I had, and again, thank you for your service.
Well, this concludes this morning's hearing. I'd like to remind all members that our next hearing is going to be on March the 2nd at 9:30 a.m. in 2359 Rayburn. With the Secretary of Veterans Affairs, Bob McDonald. So thank you all for your testimony. Appreciate it. And I think we want to do some pictures. So this meeting is adjourned.